Tim Shoemaker. Brother Tim, y'all know he's ill. He's in the hospital today, and so we talked about it a little bit, and I don't know if it was a smart move or not, but I said, I'll do it, and then I went off to figure out exactly what I was going to do, but I did a class, I guess it's a couple of years back now, on contradictions in the Bible. Are there any contradictions in the Bible? And that seemed to be a pretty good one-off to do tonight. I didn't have time to exegete all the Matthew that we would have had to do to do carry on Matthew tonight. But anyway, it's a good question, because a lot of people, unbelievers, will say, well, that's one of the reasons I just don't believe in the Bible. I don't believe in Christianity and all that y'all propose, because there's so many contradictions in the Bible. And so I think that's a pretty good thing for us to study tonight. If y'all would, let's get our class started with a word of prayer. Father, we love you, and we thank you for this book, this divine record that you have handed to us and have made yourself so well known. You've taught us who we are, and you've taught us how we might live in such a way that we can have eternity with you. And we thank you for the great gift that your Bible is. Father, we just pray that you be with us tonight and help us to examine this question honestly and openly, with an eye towards the truth. Help us to know the truth about whether or not there are contradictions in your word. Help us to see it for ourselves, and not just because somebody else told us something. But Father, help us to examine these things and come to the right conclusions. Father, we pray these things in your Son Jesus' name, and amen. There was an atheist by the name of Sam Harris in 2009. I have a link to the PDF if you want to go see this for yourself. He put together a chart of what he claimed were the 439 unique Bible contradictions. Now, we don't have time tonight to go through 439, but if you want to see the chart for yourself, it's an interesting thing to look over. We're going to go through several of these, and we're going to talk about some principles, some big overarching principles that will probably help you to knock out chunks of these contradictions at a time, because over and over again, they use the same approach, just in different texts. And so I want to kind of take that tack tonight. I do want to say this. If just one of these contradictions is true, we're in trouble. If just one is true, because it means that one of two things is true. If God is found to be perfect and trustworthy, and yet this book is found to not be perfect and trustworthy, that means that this book is not from God. And so that could be one thing that it means. If this book is found to be not perfect and not trustworthy, and it does come from God, secondly, it means that God is not perfect and trustworthy. And then how do I base my life on anything that he says? How do I know what's true and what's false? If just one contradiction comes true, then we're in trouble. So we need to take this charge seriously. We need to look at it openly and honestly. We need to be truth lovers. And so let's try to do that. Let's dig into it. I do want to say one important note before we really get into it right off the bat. We need to apply this question to the text as they were originally written. The paper that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and all those guys that they put pen to, we need to apply the question to those texts. Translations will come into the mix. A lot of times somebody will pick up a translation and say, here is a contradiction, and you look at it, and it's not really that they're applying it to those divine words that came right out of the mind of God. 2 Peter 1:21, it tells us men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit, but it does not say that every man thereafter would be inspired of God. Translations are an uninspired work trying to portray the inspired original. It's the work of uninspired men. Translations can have mistakes in them, and we need to realize that and recognize it right up front. Some funny ones. The 1562 edition of the Geneva Bible, blessed are the placemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Not placemakers, it's peacemakers, but they made a translation error there, a printing error. You may have heard of the 1631 King James Version of the Bible. In Exodus chapter 20 and 14, they forgot the word not. Exodus 20 and 14 says, thou shalt not commit adultery. And so, that was a pretty important printing mistake. They destroyed most of those right off the bat. There are 11 in existence today. Last time I saw one going on auction, it was fetching $100,000. It's called the Wicked Bible. Just a interesting note of history there. There's printing errors. There are translation errors too, though. Does anybody, I'm going to give out some verses to read if y'all don't mind, because I'll end up talking too much if I don't. Could somebody from a King James translation read for us Isaiah 34 and 7? Isaiah 34 and 7. I'm not picky. Anybody that gets there first. Now, Willie, do you have a King James translation? The New King James. Somebody from the old King James, if you don't mind. Darnell, yes. All right. The Bible says unicorns exist. Is that right? Is that what we just heard there? The unicorns shall come down from them. Now, what's that? It's nine times in the King James Version of the Bible, the word unicorn is used. You're probably right. I just know nine times. Isaiah 34, 7 and 8 others. Yes, nine appearances in the King James Version of the Bible. Does the Bible then teach us that unicorns exist? No. From the perception, the worldview of the translators in 1611, that's 400 years ago, from the limited knowledge of the Hebrew language in 1611, you have to understand as more texts are discovered, and secular texts even, when the translators try to figure out what is the Bible saying, it helps if you're trying to get into the Greek. How did Plato use this word? How did Aristotle use this word? How did Socrates use this word? And the more that you can discover of, and especially a dead language, the more text you can get context with, the better you can understand the language. Well, from the limited understanding of Hebrew in 1611, from their perceptions of whether unicorns may or may not exist, unicorns seem to be an acceptable word to put into the text then. Now most, as Willie read, texts will say wild oxen, and that's really a better translation. Translation errors exist. The translators have their own worldview, their own idea of what the language means. And so as we're looking for contradictions, Sam Harris would point to that and say, well, you Christians are ignorant. You think unicorns exist. Well, you have to understand. We need to look at the original text. And so that's a biggie. That's the biggie that we need to address right up front. Step number two, once we get beyond that, though, we need to understand that the writings rarely tell us everything there is to know about a subject. Let's say that me and my family went to the mall, and afterwards you talked to each of us separately and you asked us, what'd you do? Where'd you go? And I said, well, we went to Sears and we went to Belk. And you talked to Priscilla and she says, oh, we went to Belk and Rack Room Shoes. You talked to Whit. He says, we went to the arcade. You talked to Brooke. She says, we went to the food court. Now, are we just a bunch of liars? Because none of our stories match. We're not saying the same thing at all. Well, we're not telling you everything that we could tell you. Maybe we both went to Belk, but then we split up, and I went to Sears, and she went to Rack Room. All he cared about was the arcade, but we really didn't go in there. We just passed by, but that's what he remembers, and Brooke likewise with the food court. The writers are the same way. They're not a bunch of liars just because they give you different accounts. Well, they just saw things from different views, and they keyed in on different aspects of the same overall truth. Let's take this for example, because this is one of the contradictions in the list. What did it say on the sign above Jesus on the cross? What did that sign say? Well, let's look at all the accounts. It's in every single gospel. Let's read what that sign did say. Again, let me hand out some texts. I got four of them, if y'all would be ready with these texts. Somebody go to Matthew 27 and 37 and be ready with that one. Somebody else go to Luke 23 and 38, and please be ready with that one. Mark 15 and 26, and lastly, John 19, 19. That's the four gospel recordings of what that sign did say. Now, could somebody, I wish I had a whiteboard to write these down. Try to remember them, what they say. Could somebody read for us Matthew 27 and 37?
Set up over 10 in the temple.
"This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Now, your text probably has it like in all cap letters, as though, I mean, we are reading this. There you go, kind of like that. I mean, this, if you're writing this down as a gospel writer, you should be getting this verbatim, right? I mean, this is what it said. Quotes, verbatim, what the sign says. "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." What does Luke 23:38 say? Who has it? "This is the King of the Jews." The exact same thing Matthew said, except for it omits the word Jesus. "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Luke says, "This is the King of the Jews." What did Mark say? Mark 15 and 26. "The King of the Jews." We're getting shorter. Now this should be verbatim, but so far not one of our three matches. "The King of the Jews." What did John say? John 19 and 19. "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." We haven't seen the word Nazareth until we get to John. We got four different writers, not one of the four matches. They should be giving us verbatim what the sign says. Is this a contradiction? Well, let's think about it. In John 19 and verse 20, it tells us that this sign was written in Aramaic and in Latin and in Greek. Aramaic for the Jews. Aramaic was the conversant language of the day. Hebrew was starting to fall out of use. Aramaic was for the Jews. You have Latin for the Romans, and you have Greek. Greek was like English. It was the universal language of the day. It was written in three languages. Well, now, let's think about it for a second then. We have four different writings, none of them match, but there's three different signs. There's not just one sign, is there? There's three different signs. You've got the Latin sign, you've got the Greek sign, and you've got the Roman sign. So they're already... we have some possibilities. Maybe this one's reading that one. And you know what? Matthew was writing to who? He was writing to the Jews. Luke was writing to who? He was writing to the Greeks. Mark was writing to the Romans. So it already kind of was starting to make sense. John's a little different, but John most likely is writing to the Romans as well. So we've still got a little bit of an issue there, but it's starting to get a little bit clearer that, well, maybe we've got a contradiction between Mark and John because they don't say the same thing either, but we're starting to get there. Mark tells us, what does Mark tell us? He said this was the inscription of the charge against him. This is the charge. This is what he's being crucified for. So John says, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Mark just says, "The King of the Jews." Well, this was the charge. This is what he's getting crucified for. He said he was the King of the Jews. They give us differing perspectives. This one said rack room shoes. This one said Sears. So there's no contradiction here. They're just reading different signs and giving us different pictures of those signs. So we have no contradiction in a translation error. We have no contradiction when they give us different perspectives of the same event. Step number three, they may be talking about the same thing, but are they talking about it in the same sense? Let's say that Leroy Jones tells us that he is rich beyond your wildest imaginations. And then you go and you look at Leroy Jones's bank account, and he's got barely enough to feed himself from day to day. Is that a contradiction? Financially, yeah. What if Leroy Jones is a Christian? What if he's rich beyond your wildest dreams? Because he's talking about heaven. He's talking about those streets of gold. You got to understand the sense in which Leroy Jones is talking. And maybe it's a contradiction, but maybe it's not. Well, let's look at Acts chapter 9. Actually, Acts chapter 9 and chapter 22. If y'all want to compare these side by side with me for a second. We're talking specifically about a sound here. Because one text seems to say one thing about it, and the other text seems to say another. Acts chapter 9, y'all realize, y'all remember how Saul of Tarsus, he's walking on the road to Damascus, and all of a sudden he's struck by the Lord, and there is a voice that comes out of heaven. Now, what does the text say about that voice that came out of heaven? Could somebody please read for us Acts 9 and verse 7?
"The voice that
I'm sorry, is that 9 and verse 7? All right, here's the question. The men heard the voice, but they saw no one in chapter 9. Now let's look at chapter 22 and see if it says something different. Could somebody read for us Acts 22 and verse 9? ESV or New King James? ESV, I've got the ESV too. They didn't understand the voice of the one that was speaking to them. I think other translations might actually use the word hear there. Does anybody have the word hear? They did not hear. New King James says hear. I believe King James says hear as well. That makes it a little bit more contrasting, especially for those that will raise contradictions. Chapter 9 says they heard it. Chapter 22 says they did not hear it. Or the ESV says the word understand, and we'll talk about why it might say understand. Is this a contradiction? One text says they heard it, the other text says they didn't hear it. Now, it's kind of funny if it is, because you've got the same writer that wrote both, just chapters removed, so Luke seemed to forget what he wrote in chapter 9 if he's writing this in chapter 22 and meaning something different by it. But what's going on here? We're talking in different senses. Somebody says something to you, but you're playing on your iPhone and you're watching some TV, and you turn and you look at them and you say, what did you just say? I didn't hear you. Now, is that true? Of course it's not true. You heard them. You heard the sound, or else you wouldn't have responded to the sound. You heard them, but what are you saying? I didn't comprehend the words that you were saying to me. I didn't hear the message that you were trying to convey. I heard the sound, but I didn't catch the message that you were trying to give to me. Well, it's a little technical, but one of the great wisdoms of God is the language that he used in our Bible. The Greek language in particular is much more descriptive than our English language even is, as descriptive as the English language is. It was a blessing that the Greek language died. And it's a blessing because it stopped in its form that it had then, the Koine anyway, and it didn't evolve past that. You want to study the English language, it's kind of difficult because it keeps morphing, it keeps evolving. The English language, at what point? Well, the Koine language, not the same thing. The Koine language dies, and as we study the Koine, it's the same for all time. And one of the things about the Koine is the cases that's used on verbs. I'm not going to get into this, but it's very weird if you're trying to read a Greek sentence. It's not subject, verb, object, like ours flow like that. You can put them in any order you want to, because the subject always has the same case. The object always has the same case. Well, in Acts chapter 9, we use it's called the genitive case. Acts chapter 22, it's called the accusative case. The way it all lands out, it's just getting too technical, but the way it all ends out is when you use it with the accusative, it means understand. It means I didn't understand you, what you're saying to me. And we're talking about things in a different sense here. The men heard the noise, but they didn't understand what was going on. No contradiction here. Let's look at one more step that we need to consider. And then I want to turn over some text to you guys, and y'all tell me. Let's work through some of the contradictions that Sam Harris would throw at us. The last step that we need to be aware of is that the figures of speech the Bible uses need to be considered. Psalm chapter 50 and verse 1. This doesn't contradict with another text, but it contradicts with what we know of science. Psalm chapter 50 and verse 1. It says, the mighty one, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Now, what's wrong with that sentence? The rising of the sun to its setting. Is that what really happens? No. The sun doesn't move, we do. And someone will read this and say, well, this book is just so scientifically inaccurate. The sun doesn't move. But is that a contradiction? It's not a contradiction. We say the same thing today. We use the same figure of speech today. Is all English speakers ignorant when they say the sun rose today? No, we're just using a figure of speech. And especially when we're reading a book of poetry, as the book of Psalms is, we should expect a few figures of speech. It's not a contradiction. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 6, Paul talks about 500 men, some of whom have fallen asleep. Well, we know he's not talking about snoozing. Some of them have died, but the Bible uses figures of speech sometimes, so we should expect it. That's really the big ticket items. You can knock down most of Sam Harris's 439 contradictions. If you just remember, translation errors are not errors. You have to take into consideration, am I getting a different perspective of the same overall event? Using the same word in different senses is not a contradiction, and figures of speech are not contradictions. That will get you through most of Sam Harris's list. I got a few more that I just want to turn over to you guys and let y'all tell me. How did David kill Goliath? Anybody remember how David killed Goliath? Slingshot, cut his head off. There you go, perfect. Y'all are working hand in hand. Which one was it? Was it the slingshot or was it cutting his head off? Well, let's go read 1 Samuel chapter 17. Let's read what the text says. I guess the same person can read the same, read both of them because they're right back to back. Could somebody read 49 and 50 and stop? And then we'll go over to 51. All right, you take the text to that point, and we have to conclude he killed him with a slingshot. Wasn't even a sword in his hand. The stone sank into his forehead, so he prevailed and killed him. Now, if you would continue and read verse 51 for us. Okay, well, you add that, and did he kill him with the sword? It kind of leads us to believe that maybe he did. Still not a contradiction. Still not. It would be stupid if it was a contradiction. I'll use the S word. It would be stupid if it was a contradiction. Why? The same writer just wrote it in one fluid sentence. He's not going to contradict himself even by human secular standards. But here's the thing. Let's say we're watching the Super Bowl. And 15 seconds left to go in the game, overtime. There's a fumble, and the team, the defense, picks up that fumble, and they start to run it back, and they get all the way down to the 5-yard line, and they're tackled, but there's 3 seconds left, and they kick the winning field goal, and they win the game. The headline in the newspaper the next day, Falcons win the Super Bowl on last-second fumble. Now, is that true? Not really. They didn't win the game on the fumble. They won the game on the field goal, right? That's where they made the points. That's where they won the game. Everybody remembers the fumble, though. Everybody remembers that little boy that killed a giant with a slingshot. We're going to put the slingshot in the paper. That's verse 50 is really kind of an overview verse. This is what happened broadly. This is what the people are talking about. So he prevailed with a slingshot. Well, the final breath that Goliath drew might have come after that stone sank into his forehead, broke his bone right here. Maybe the sword was the death blow, but there's no contradiction here. It makes complete sense if you are not trying not to make nonsense of it. Let's do one more. Who carried Jesus' cross? Jesus Simon. There's another one right here. Who did Jesus carried it or Simon the Cyrene carried it? Let's look. Would somebody read John 19, 17? We could read all of the gospel accounts, but the contradicting one is John. John 19, 17. Could somebody read that one? And somebody be ready to read Matthew 27, 32. 1 John. Who could get John 19, 17 for us? Okay, we don't even see the name Simon here. He bore his cross. Jesus carried it. What is Matthew? What's that? He bared it. He bore it. What does Matthew 27:32 say? Uh, seemingly a contradiction here. Jesus bore it in the Gospel of John, and all the other three synoptics, Simon the Cyrene carries it. We don't know exactly what happens. It feels like we do. There's a story that's been so prevalent it feels like scripture, but it's not. Tradition tells us that Jesus bore the cross until he stumbled under the weight of that cross. If you go over to Jerusalem today, the Via Dolorosa, the Way of Pain, from the stone pavement where Pilate sentenced him to death all the way to Golgotha itself, it has stations, the stations of the cross. One of those stations is a rock, and it is dirty because so many pilgrims go and they touch that rock over and over and over again. They touch that rock because traditionally Jesus stumbled under the weight of the cross and he put out his hand and he touched that rock. And so that's one of the stations of the cross. That's the tradition. And so Simon carried it from there forward. Scripture doesn't say that. That's just a tradition. You'll see some depictions of Jesus holding one end and Simon holding the other end. You'll see some depictions of Jesus carrying the short cross beam and Simon carrying the longer vertical beam. It could have been any one of those possibilities. The scripture doesn't settle the matter first. There are possibilities, though. It could have been that Jesus carried it until he stumbled. It could have been that Jesus and Simon tag teamed. It could have been that one carried one piece and the other carried the other piece. One of the things about contradictions is, as long as there's a plausible explanation, you have no contradiction. And that's what we have here. We can't say exactly what did happen, but we can say there's not a contradiction, or at least there doesn't have to be. There's a lot of other ones. We don't have time to go through 439, as I said. How did Judas die? Matthew 27 says he hanged himself. Acts 1 says he fell and he bust open, and so they called that place the Field of Blood. They called it the Field of Blood because that was the juicy story, not the hanging. It's because he bust and he went everywhere. I'll tell you this, a body, you trip and fall down the stairs, you're not going to bust and blood go everywhere. Only a rotten, already dead body does that. So there's no contradiction there. Who cast Jonah into the sea? Jonah chapter 1 says the sailors did. Jonah chapter 2 says that he did. But again, there's no contradiction there. The same writer wrote both. Who bought the potter's field? Same thing. When was Jesus born? Matthew says it was in the reign of one king. Luke says it was in the reign of the other king. But one is talking about Caesars and one is talking about governors. There's no contradictions in our Bible. I want to end on that good note. We, as people who seek the truth, can truthfully say we are reading a perfect book here. But if you want the PDF to look at it for yourself, it's a neat look. It's completely made up. And that's my conclusion on it anyway. Anybody have any thoughts? We're out of time, unfortunately. Anybody have any thoughts or comments on Bible contradictions? Let's close it with a word of prayer. We go to 6:15? Oh, I'm so used to Wednesday night class and having to get out of here on the dot. Well, let's look. I shouldn't have blown through those like I did. I just killed my notes. let's look at Matthew chapter 27. How did Judas die? How did Judas die? Could somebody read Matthew 27 and verse 5? And on the other end, we'll be in Acts chapter 1. Yes, sir. All right. Matthew thinks that Judas killed himself. He hung himself. But others will say, wait, no, that's not how it happened. Matthew chapter 1. Who could read verses 18 through 19? I'm sorry, in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 1 and verse 18 to 19. Kind of an interesting side note on that. Luke presupposes a Greek audience. And he's telling us a Jewish story to a Greek audience. And notice how he says, it's called in their language. All you Greek people that I'm talking to, these Jews over here, the story that I'm telling you about them and their king, in their language, they have this word. You can navigate Luke a lot better sometimes if you understand he's leaving out some of the Jewish things. When is Jerusalem going to be destroyed? Matthew chapter 24, when you see the abomination of desolation is spoken of by the prophet Daniel. What does Luke say when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies? You Greeks don't know what the abomination of desolation spoken of by the prophet Daniel is. I'll just tell you when the armies come and circle it up. Luke does that a lot. Kind of the same thing here. Let me give you the juicy story about Akadama, and he tells us about the blood in the field, but I've already kind of spoiled the reason this is not a contradiction. Bodies don't burst. We're just not made that flimsily. It was already dead. He killed himself by hanging himself, not by falling down and hitting a rock real bad. And so we don't have a contradiction here at all. Let's look a little bit deeper into this text as well, because we're also told something about the potter's field. Could somebody back up in Matthew 27 and read verses 3 through 7 for us, and we'll compare it back against the Acts text again. Matthew 27, 3 through 7. Okay, so he bought this field. What does verse 18 in Acts chapter 1 say? Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't take it far enough in Matthew there. It says the chief priest took that silver, or I didn't catch it when it came through. The chief priest taking the silver said it's not lawful, and then they went and they bought the potter's field. There will be some that raise a contradiction here, and it says, well, Acts said that Judas bought that field. In Matthew it says that the priests bought that field, and so we have a contradiction here. Y'all can see, we start to see just how weak these proposed contradictions really are. This book has been put to more scrutiny than any other book in history. We have scant few copies of Homer's works, say, or any other book from antiquity. We have thousands and thousands and thousands of manuscripts of the Bible, and yet it's put to so much more scrutiny. Nobody would say Homer didn't write the Iliad. Now, Homer didn't really say that in the Odyssey. We just take it on, well, that's what we have. This book is perfect. Nobody would say there's a contradiction here, but yet Sam Harris says there is. Let's do look at where Jesus was born, or when Jesus was born. Matthew chapter 2, 1, and Luke chapter 2, 1. Could somebody read Matthew chapter 2 and verse 1 for us? Okay, in the days of Herod, king of Judea. Now, what does Luke chapter 2 and verse 1 say? I'm really just disappointed in the ignorance of someone who should be a more learned man. To say that this is a contradiction. Well, one text says that it was when Caesar was king, and one text says it's when Herod was king. That's no contradiction. It's just like saying in the days when Barack Obama was reigning, in the days of Governor Bentley. There's no contradiction in saying that you've got one ruler or another ruler when they both rule concurrently. And that's this thing when Caesar Augustus was reigning, Herod was also governor of Judea. There's no contradiction here. And yet men like Sam Harris will raise this text and say, well, look, there's one king in one text, but a different king in another text. It's really, usually when somebody raises a contradiction, the first thought is, okay, what wordplay are you trying to use on me here? What switch, twist are you trying to do here? Because I almost say 10 times out of 10, there's no contradiction. It's just trying to twist the text to where it looks like there is. There's no contradiction at all here. Let's go back and look at Jonah. Who cast Jonah into the sea? Jonah chapter 1 and verse 15. Could somebody read that one for us? All right, so the they being the sailors, the men there that Jonah said, please y'all throw me into the sea. But if we read on, what does it say there in chapter 2, verses 1 through 3? Okay, so we kind of on face value of the words here, we have a contradiction. The men threw him into the sea, but what does he say there in chapter 2? You threw me into the sea. He's praying to God there. He says, God threw him into the sea. First of all, though, we know that we've got poetic, flowery language here in chapter 2. For one reason, he says, I'm calling out to you from the belly of Sheol. We would say from the belly of Hades, or you might actually go so far, the belly of hell. Literally, is he in the belly of Hades? No, that's not where he is, literally. Literally, he's in a fish. But he's speaking poetically. He's speaking figuratively. You threw me down here. Well, in a sense, I guess you could say that. God caught up to him with the storm. God caused the situation that led him to be thrown into the sea. That's kind of a lesson to us. God can catch up with us. Yes, that's right out of God Speaks Today. You know, am I speaking directly or indirectly? Y'all remember that? I won't go through the whole thing, but you're exactly right. You know, you tell somebody and they act as an agent on your behalf, but it's really not the same. Well, now that's true too. Yeah, God was getting them there one way or another. No contradiction here. This is, and again, yes.
And sometimes the Bible is a river of understanding of the people at the time. I mean,
yes.
God made two great lights, one for the day, one for the night. We understand that the moon is just reflecting the sun. It's not a great light, but it was kind of hard to explain that scientifically to people. Until the 15th century, the world was flat.
That's a great point. Yes, God's always met people where they're at, and we can back up and see some things that they wouldn't have seen right off back then. When we read the circle of the earth there in the book of Isaiah, well, we know more about that than they did, but they could have climbed up to a pretty tall mountain and seen okay, yeah, there's some curvature out there, maybe. They could have grasped at it, but they couldn't have seen a picture from Apollo or something like that. Let's look. I got one more. I had the perfect time and just didn't know it. Let's look at Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2. There's claims to be a contradiction here. And the question is, from what were the animals created? It seems to say one thing in chapter 1 and another thing in chapter 2. But from what were the animals created? Let's read chapter 2 first, because that'll make chapter 1 make a little more sense. Could somebody read Genesis 2:19? Okay, so out of the ground, the Lord made the animals just like he made you and me, out of the dust of the ground. But you go back to chapter 1, and I'll point out in verse 25, he also says from the ground, God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. What did it say from the ground? I read it just a second ago. Somebody see that where it says from the ground? Yeah, 2:19. And maybe I saw the word ground in 25 and just did a transposition there. There you go. That's it. Verse 24, the earth is bringing forth again from the ground. So we got an agreement there. Thank you. I told y'all I kind of threw this together last minute, right? Thank you. From the ground in both of those places. But what does verse 20 say? Chapter 1 and verse 20. Well, there we have the waters bring forth abundantly. And so some will raise a contradiction here. In verse 2:19, it says he created all the animals out of the dust of the ground. But back in chapter 1, he said waters were bringing forth. Now, I think that's a translation thing. My ESV says, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures. It's not saying he made them out of water. It could be that. It could be our rack room shoes and Sears example, where one is giving us a slice from this way and the others giving a slice from this way. Some will make much of chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Genesis, by the way, because you have a doublet. You have a repeating of the creation account from chapter 1 to chapter 2. And some will say, well, that's just kind of weird in and of itself. There's a lot of criticism that we could get into real quick with that, but it gets really deep. It gives us different slices of the pie, is the best we can say about it. No contradiction. Any other thoughts as we kind of come to the end of Bible contradictions? They don't exist. So we could probably have a whole quarter on that kind of thing, but they're not there. But let's close with a word of prayer. Father, again, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the perfection that we read here that lets us know that you are perfect. That as your word never contradicts itself, we can begin to build a trust that you will never contradict yourself. That everything that you produce is perfect, that you have given us the free will, and yes, we've used that to mess some things up and to be imperfect, but you have never created anything that was imperfect. And Father, please help for us to use this appreciation that we have for your word to teach others likewise to see your perfection. And Father, help us to know your word more and more every day so that we might be more and more like you. Father, we pray these things in your Son, Jesus' name, and amen.